Let me tell you this. Just sometimes you don't realize. We tend to see things very much through our own eyes, and sometimes we forget that there are other people's eyes that come to church too. And sometimes you don't recognize the hardships that some of the folks are going through that you go to church with. And I won't stand up here and tell you all the different stories I know from meeting with individual people. But let me tell you, ladies and gentlemen, there are some folks, even within the sound of my voice, it takes all the faith they have to get out of bed and put their shoes on, let alone come to church. And they've been so beaten up through the circumstances of life. And sometimes there are situations out there, truly, where people were just born into a very difficult situation, or they inherited a very difficult situation. And until they've been exposed to the gospel long enough to produce the miraculous change in their life, the amount of pain they carry is overwhelming. And man, for them to come in here and for you to put a hug on them, to give them a smile, to be available to pray with them, to just be there for them, ladies and gentlemen, we'll never know the value of that until eternity. And I just share with you, whether it's the way we come to church, the way we praise God, recognize that it has more to do than just you. It's about the people around you. And I've said this so many times, and it bears repeating so many more times. Just as a young kid from a broken home, the few times that we got to church, and it was hell on earth coming to church. I mean, the parents fought the whole way there. They yelled, they screamed. Many times we got halfway there and turned around and went home. I know maybe some of you have been there at some point in your life. And I was the kid. But the times I made it, we'd usually sit back. We always sat on this side of the congregation. We'd sit toward the back. I would watch, and there was always a few men you could watch that would be into praise and worship. They'd have their hands lifted. You could tell they were treating their wives correctly. And as a little 4-year-old or 5-year-old or 6-year-old, I recognized that's what I want to be when I grow up. And you probably don't know some of the most horrendous situations that could ever happen to human beings have happened to people in this church. And sometimes it's going to take them years to recover. And ladies and gentlemen, just it's so important. We come as the body of Christ in love, full of faith, full of the Holy Spirit, full of the goodness of God, full of the joy of the Lord. And we don't judge people here. And we know people have hard lives. We know people made bad choices. We know that. But they're not going to be able to turn their lives around if we don't, as a church, embrace them, love them, put up with their junk, put up with their stuff, put up with their issues, sometimes for 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, sometimes we have to put up with it for 10 years. But man, at some point we have faith, there's going to be a breakthrough, you see. And we want to love those people with everything we got. And I'll tell you, you know, the sheep, when we look at Psalm 3, the story of a shepherd, the psalm of a shepherd, and the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And one of the things a shepherd would do at the end of the day is he would look through his sheep, and the land of Israel was very rocky, a lot of jagged rocks through the mountainous terrain, and as those sheep were grazing and walking, they would get cuts on their heads, cuts on their feet as they were walked. And at the end of the day, a loving shepherd would have what's called an oil, basically olive oil, and would take those sheep and anoint those cuts with oil as salve to help bring healing to that wound. And there are folks that come in here on a regular basis, and they're hurting, they're beat up, they've been out there at mountainous terrain. And this isn't just for adults, this is for young people. Listen, we know statistically 1 in 3 of these young ladies is going to be molested at some point in her life. We pray the blood of Jesus over each and every one of them, that doesn't happen in Jesus' name. And we train our young men to be fine, quality young men. But I got to tell you, sometimes they get in at they come to church after that's already happened. It can take a long time to bring that type of healing, ladies and gentlemen. And I got to tell you, we've got to be anointed by the Holy Ghost to bring the oil of the Holy Spirit, the oil of comfort, the oil of healing, the oil of help, the oil of that the supernatural power of God that only God can do to reach into people's lives and transform their lives. Amen. Amen. Well, that being said, let's dismiss our children, our teenagers. God bless you as you go. We love you dearly. You are the church of today. You're not the church of tomorrow. You're the church of today. And many times when God is looking to raise up a revival, when God is looking to raise up leaders, he looks to young people like a 14-year-old Mary, a 16-year-old David, an 8-year-old Josiah, a 7-year-old Jehaziel, a 12-year-old Samuel. God uses children, and we teach these young people all the time, you are not the church of tomorrow. You are the church of today. Amen. Praise God. Well, we're just full of good news, but we had Kathy just got back from Israel. And so I asked Kathy, come up and share for just a couple minutes, if you would, and tell us about your trip and maybe one or two highlights that really touched you. And I realize that you've got to try to fit 10, 12 days into 2 minutes. That's impossible. I do it every Sunday. Okay. Praise God. So do the best you can.
I will.
All right. Thank you.
Here's what you do. You go like this and you want me to quit.
Okay. All right.
I'll
have Kurt do that.
Yeah. I was actually gone 21 days. My longest trip ever. So I would like to say to you this morning in Hebrew, Boker Tov, which is good morning. Boker Tov. Yes. Kurt hears that and says, broken toe. I don't think I'm ever going to get him to Israel. How to sum up a 21-day trip to Israel in less than 5 minutes? You can't. Last Sunday, I fellowshipped at the Jerusalem Baptist Church. It was awesome. They have a Russian-speaking congregation on Friday night and a Hebrew-speaking congregation on Saturday and a English-speaking congregation on Sunday, and it was just precious. It was a lot less folks than we have here, maybe 75 people at the most, but they had a quartet that got up and sang, one guy from South America, one guy from the United States, one guy from Norway, one guy from Africa somewhere. It was just amazing. If I could bring anything to you, first of all, it would be great thanks, and I think Pastor Matt did get an email. But the things that you donated went to two places. They went to a place called Daliat HaKarmel, which is near Haifa, not in Haifa. It's in a little Druze village called Isafia. And they have a shelter there. And their shelter is for women and children. And the women that they minister to are all African who have walked from places like the Sudan. Walked in order to get to Israel, in order to get away from the oppression and the rape and the horrible things that happen in their lives under, under Muslim rule. So your items, your baby bottles and sippy cups and toiletries and so on and so forth, most of that went to the shelter at Daliat HaKarmel. I have pictures, which I'll share with Pastor Matt. I have a video that I brought home. And then the rest of your items that you donated went to a place in East Jerusalem. And see, I wish I could stand here and explain to you the political landscape of Israel, because until you go, you just don't know. You're here, you're there, you're in and out of the West Bank, you're in the Palestinian territories, now you're back in Israel proper. But in East Jerusalem, there's a little, tiny, about the size of our foyer, bookstore, Christian folks ministering to the Arab-speaking population of East Jerusalem. So the rest of your items, whether they were coloring books or crayons or baby bottles or sippy cups or whatever, the rest of your items mainly went to Ravi and Laura, who are in their late 20s, two little children. He's from Switzerland, she's from the United States. They gave up their lives basically to go to minister to people, knowing about the oppression and the danger that they live in, because they live totally in the Muslim community is where they live. But guess what? Muslims are coming to Jesus. Amen. Muslims are coming to Jesus.
Yes.
And your gifts to the folks at Daliat Carmel, most of those women coming up, you know, they're Muslim as well. And what happens is they stay for a while, and eventually they do come to Jesus. So, you know, we saw a lot of sites. We had a first-time lady with us, and she wanted to see everything. So we saw a lot of sites. But the thing that blesses me about going to Israel is interacting with the people. We had one day when our first-time lady celebrated her 70th birthday. We're staying right on the shore of the Sea of Galilee in a Jewish hotel. We went out that morning on a worship boat owned by the only Christian who does boat trips on the Sea of Galilee, staying in a Jewish hotel. The maitre d' in the dining room is a Muslim, and he served my friend Judy this beautiful, elaborate dessert plate for her birthday, put a hat on her head. It's very multicultural. For the most part, everybody gets along. It's not what you see on TV. So if you've ever had a desire to go to Israel, I hope you go, because as I tell everybody, you can't go when you're any younger than you are now. And so I hope that God will set your heart on fire for Israel. It's very, 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 very important. Now, I appreciate your prayers and your support. I had a few people that gave me money. That money helped to get your items to Israel, since the airlines nowadays are very skimpy on what they allow you to take. And you helped make this trip a tremendous success. So I want to thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Kathy. Thank you. Thank you. Praise the Lord. You know, we've had wonderful experiences over the last year, taking folks to Mexico, taking folks to Brazil. Praise God. Let's pray and get into the word today. Lord, we love you. We praise you. We exalt you. We ask you to put me on as your microphone. Lord, there's so many things in my heart to say this morning. So many. Lord, help me to sift through what is most important to say today. In Jesus' name, amen. Matthew chapter 21. This is one of my favorite Sundays of the year. It's Palm Sunday. And the older I get, the more important it becomes to me to recognize this is the significance of the week that Jesus would be crucified and rise from the dead. And we'll read the account. Matthew chapter 21, we'll read the first 11 verses. And this is how it starts. Now when they drew near Jerusalem and came to Bethpage at the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord has need of them. And immediately he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them. They brought the donkey and the colt, laid their clothes on them, and set him on them. And a very great multitude spread their clothes on the road. Others cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Then the multitudes who went before and those who followed cried out, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when they had come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, who is this? So the multitude said, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee. And Jesus would go from there to the temple, where he would take the whips of cords, overturn tables, drive out the money changers, and begin to cause a great scene. Jesus really stepped up his ministry in the last week. I say this every year, and it bears repeating it on this week. About 25% of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John revolve around 1 week. Okay, from here it's Matthew 21 to 28 revolve around that 1 week. And when you look at the other Gospels, it's about 25% of each Gospel is given to the last week of Jesus on earth. That is a significant week. Jesus intensified his ministry significantly because he understood the time. He understood this is it. We've come down to this. And I tell you, there's so many things we can draw from this morning, but one of the things I want to draw is, as the church of Jesus Christ, we've got to recognize time is so important. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't want to preach extremism or legalism, but I will tell you, ladies and gentlemen, we are coming, I believe with all my heart, something is happening spiritually behind the scenes, and every person I know who's prophetically inclined in their ministry is saying something is coming, something is coming. All the signs are pointing, something is about to change, and I want to be on the right side of it. I want to be ready for it. And when my master comes, I want him to find me not only faithful, but fruitful. And I want to tell us all, ladies and gentlemen, as the church of Jesus Christ, this is no time to play church. And we need, if anything, to intensify our pursuit of God and his commission to reach souls on this earth. And I saw here the donkey, and this I'll get into a little bit of next week, but man, that donkey, it was actually a colt. We see Jesus rode the colt, and but that colt carried Jesus into the city. I don't know about you, but I want to be the church of that donkey, praise God. I want to be the donkey that Jesus rides on to get the church to the city and to let people know that Jesus is in the house. Can I get a good bah? Amen. I guess if donkey goes, I need to go back to Farmer in the Dell, I guess, or whatever it is. But a good hee-haw. My. We need to be donkeys, and our lives are carrying Jesus for such a time as this. Let me share this with you, and there's more in my heart than I could ever share on this today. This will come out in the next few weeks and months. But I'm one of those people, I believe the Word of God. And I believe that God is no respecter of persons, and I believe that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And I believe that there are some terrible things happening in our nation and in our world. But I believe that God's will is to save as many people as he possibly can out of that world. And I believe that God will use people and God will use churches for such an act. And we see all throughout the Word of God, we see all throughout history, when God wants something done, he raises up somebody. And I believe there's a very good chance at some point in the next 18 months to 10 years, I believe God is going to come to this church and ask us to do something for him. And what do you mean by that, Pastor Matt? I believe there's going to come a time where God is going to ask us to be a special donkey, to carry the presence of Jesus to the Midwest and to host his presence in a very, very special way. And there's many of you who've had dreams and visions, literal dreams and visions of this over the years. I need you to write those down for me, and I want to lay them all out before the Lord. I believe it's very significant, and it's several people. And you say, oh, that sounds wonderful. Well, not really. Yes, it is. But I'm going to preach on what that means later on in the spring or early summer. You know, we need to be like Mary and say, Lord, be it unto me. We need to be like Isaiah, say, here I am, send me. You know, I don't want to be, oh, I don't have time for you. Oh, that'll mess up my schedule. That'll mess up the way we do church. That'll mess things up. It will mess things up. Jesus will bring a mess to your town. Jesus messes things up. He messed up the religious system. He messed up the temple. He messed up the leaders. He messed up the government. He messed everything up. By the time it was done, people were tearing roofs off houses. Pigs were running off of cliffs. It will mess up your world. But don't we need our world to be messed up from what it is now? And when I go to the Lord in prayer, ladies and gentlemen, and someone would say, how dare he say something like that? Who's he think he is? I know who I am. My name is Pastor Matt Nichols. I'm a 6'7" preacher who's like a teddy bear, who's just a hick from Ohio, that now a hick from Indiana, that every now and then, not a hick, but mostly I'm a hick. And sometimes I say oil, sometimes I say oil. I don't even know whatever, you know, if I speak Southern or Northern, we're right on the border, aren't we? I'm just a hick. T.L. Osborne said, I'm just a hick from Oklahoma. One of the greatest missionaries of the last 100 years. I'm just a hick. I'm just an average guy who believes the word of God. Amen. And who loves my country. I love my country. I love what my country stands for. I love my heritage. And I love our people of this land. And I hope you love them with me. And I don't know about you, but I'm going to shoot for the stars. And if I miss, all right, I'd rather aim high and miss than aim low and hit it. Amen. Let's believe God. I'm never going to quit believing for revival. I'm never going to quit believing. Does that mean that there are some things that are very imminent in our future if we don't change the nation? Yes, there are. Sure there are. I'm nowhere close to what I wanted to preach today, but ask yourself this question. Because I think even if Jesus did come and move in a wonderful way, I think half the people of America would say, I don't want to. It would interfere with soccer. It would interfere with my schedule. I got this thing, you know. And I'm hungry and, you know, I got this thing. I'm busy. I need some me time. Need some me time. And I mean, seriously, let's just say Jesus himself showed up and started having a revival like he did back in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and go in the wilderness and for days on end preach and do signs and wonders, miracles. Will we be too busy? Would we? I got this thing. And I'm asking that rhetorically in anticipation. I do believe God is going to move. I believe God's going to do wonderful things. And when he begins to, I don't want to tell God we're too busy. I got this thing. I want to tell God, like Mary. Going to mess up your life, Mary. Going to mess up your marriage. You're going to get married and already be pregnant. Joseph, you know how those men are. They might have a hard time with that. You're going to have to flee. You can't live at home for a couple years. You'll eventually watch your son be crucified. But we need you. Be it unto me. And may I tell you, when it comes to the things of God and God moving, it will mess up your life. It will mess up your religion. It will mess up your process. It will mess up preconceived notions. mess up your me time. Be it unto me. I preached this message in Bible college the first time I really preached an actual message, and it was the first time the Bible college professor stood up. And back then we had tapes, and you could buy tapes of everything. And the professor stood up and said, every one of you needs to buy the tape from today's message. And I preached this message. I said, Patrick Henry said, give me liberty or give me death. And I said, we as Christians need to burn those words in our spirit. Give me revival or give me death. Give me revival or give me death. Oh, we need revival in this nation. We need revival. I haven't studied it completely. There's a lot of chatter right now about the religious freedom bill that just passed in Indiana. I don't want to comment on it too because I have not completely read the bill. I've partially read it. And do I believe in the validity of the bill? Ultimately, yes. Just from the perspective, number one, it doesn't say what the media is making it out to say. You need to read the bill. It doesn't say anything close to what it's being politicized as on either side. On either side. But number two, I would not want an African American baker to have to bake a cake. The two men dressed in Klan suits, and on their cake they asked for a noose decoration. Would that be okay? Are you sure? Because everybody who's criticizing this bill, that's what they want. But they won't say it that way. They say it against Christians. Well, I wouldn't want a Jewish baker to have to bake a cake for two goths with swastika tattoos that come in and say, we want a swastika cake. We're having an anti-Semitic party and we want a cake. But do we expect that to happen? No. But that's not what's being portrayed in the media. But that's what this bill is designed to protect. It's designed also to protect me from having to do a homosexual wedding. But it doesn't use those words. And all this bill is a reflection of the First Amendment. And that's really sad that it's getting so much negative press, because all this bill is doing is instating the First Amendment at the state level. Now, on the other side of the coin, ladies and gentlemen, homosexuals are not going to come to Christ if we do not love them. It's not going to happen. And if I was a restaurant owner or business person in the community, I'd have a hard time refusing service to anybody. Psalms 119, 165, those that love God's word, nothing causes them to stumble. You see. And now there are certain exceptions to that, of course there are. Yeah. When it crosses religious lines, that's when the exceptions need to be made, and that's what this bill says. But to be just discriminate for the sake of not liking somebody, no, we can't do that. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Well, this kind of deep stuff this morning, amen?
Amen.
But let's jump in. I got a few minutes here left for the message. Turn in your Bible to Exodus chapter 4. And the other thing, the interesting thing about that bill, we're the 19th state to pass such a bill. And bill or no bill? Two things. Number one, I'm not going to violate my religious conscience whether I have a bill or not, and neither are you. And number two, sinners aren't going to change because we have a bill. They aren't going to change. My concern that keeps coming to me is the need that when we're talking about the lost people of the world, if we go about our Christianity as methodical, as going through the motions, okay, I know you're going to hell, I guess I'll go tell you about Jesus, all right. Hey, you want to go to church with me? No, okay. That's not cutting it. Hey, my pastor said I'm supposed to ask you to go to church. You want to go to church? We fasted for 21 days. I hope you fasted. I hope you participated. If not, start now. Give it a week. Give it a week. We get so busy. And all of our, these stupid little phones, when you have free time, we get on those stupid phones and play games and look at Facebook to look at people you don't like to see what they're doing so you can judge them. Tell you what, I saw one the other day. I said, I'm going to throw a book at your face and call it Facebook, praise God. And in the process, we lose the time of reflection. We lose the time of meditation. We lose the time of being still and knowing that He is God. We lose we're distracted by so many distractions and over time, we grow callous to the things of God. We grow callous to the reality of hell. We grow callous to the reality that you may have somebody that lives 100 yards from your house, that if they're not reached, they will spend eternity in hell. And as I read of Hudson Taylor and Charles Spurgeon and the greats of old, as I read of Charles Finney, I find that they didn't have just a casual approach of, hey, you want to go to church with me? It's Easter Sunday. My pastor wants you to go. Come on, let's go. But they would go with tears and be up at night praying for hours on end to pray for the lost, and they could feel the flames of hell enveloping the people they were talking to and recognize if they did not get them saved, it was possible they would spend eternity in hell. And just because someone told them, no, I don't want this Jesus, they could not just accept that. They would, with tears in their eyes, say, but you don't understand, but you don't understand, but you don't understand. And they would go time and time and time and time again. Passion Week. Let's shake things up. Let's turn some tables over. Let's be the donkey that carries Jesus. I always advocate balance. We have to stay in balance. We can't be extremists. We can't be legalists. But do we burn? Do we burn? Has it the condition of our country moved you to pray for an hour the last week? We'll watch news for hours on end. We'll talk about how bad it is for hours on end. What has that changed? Except for our outlook and our level of faith and our saltiness to the world. Because can I tell you what sinners don't want to hear? Sinners don't want to hear how bad it is. They don't want to hear about the Religious Freedom Bill. They don't want to hear about why we think Obamacare is bad. They don't want to hear about any of that. Jesus said, go and give them what? Good news. What is the good news? Jesus loves you. You know, one of the great sins of the charismatic movement that I grew up in, the full gospel movement, is we turned all the gifts of the Spirit inward. And it became a bless me club. Is this all right? Do I need to get back in? Is this okay? I'm not too deep, am I? All right. Y'all all right this morning? Okay. All right. This is not scripted. I'm just speaking out of my heart. We'll try to do it second service. We don't know if it'll happen or not. Maybe they'll get a message. I think my heart's big enough for two services, though. Praise God. Who let the dogs out? Who? Oh, my goodness. But is it bad out there? Oh, yeah, you know it is. And that's why our jobs become all the more important. Yeah, turning the gifts into inward. And I believe the gifts of the Holy Spirit are for today. There's nine of them listed in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. There's many more throughout the book of Romans and throughout the Word of God. But the main nine gifts of the Holy Spirit, which are the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, prophecy, the working of miracles, the gift of faith, tongues, the interpretation of tongues, and the discerning of spirits. There's nine gifts there. And we would conduct church services to use all those gifts on each other to bless each other. And anytime someone got in a jam, they'd want to come to church and get a word of prophecy. We went from prophesying to prophelying. And oh, the Lord hears your cry in the secret place, and He's seen your worship and the hard times you've gone through, and behold, He has a wonderful plan for you to turn your life around. And you put one arm in, you put one arm out, and you do the hokey pokey, and you turn yourself about, and that's what God's going to do for you. And that's about what it came down to. And it was just Christians ministering to Christians, and there was a season we needed that to restore the gifts into the body of Christ. But the reason they were restored was not so that we could use them on each other as a bless me club. It was so that we could take those gifts into the highways and the byways. And when we stopped doing that, God's hand of blessing came off of that. And there were many people who wanted to continue in the gifts without the purpose of the gifts. And in doing so, they did so without the blessing of God. And in doing so, that's where they got goofy. You know, I was going to minister on this later, but I'll minister on it today. So the word of knowledge, the word of wisdom, those are spiritual gifts of the Holy Spirit. What that is God gives you information about somebody else for the sake of helping them in that area, okay, or helping them come to Christ in some way, shape, or form. And sometimes in the church, We've spiritualized that, especially in the 80s, you know, in the televangelist type of thing. I feel the Lord is telling me, Brother Rick, the Lord is telling me that you have this, you have back pain. We can say that about almost anybody, can't we? I feel the Lord telling me there are people here with back pain. Well, sure, that took a lot of faith to have that one. I feel there are people here with problems. So. But the gifts, and quite frankly, it freaked a lot of people out. And that is freaky. But the way they work is, the way they're supposed to work, is as you're in prayer, you feel a burden. You feel an unction, something you can't explain. And all of a sudden, just something that says, you know, I've really got Lisa on my heart. I feel like I need to pray for Lisa. And you pray for Lisa, or you pray for Willard, or a sinner. God forbid we pray for a sinner. And as you're praying, you feel the tiniest of tiny, still, small voices you've ever heard. Just you can't explain it other than it's just a still, small, tiny, little voice. And all that is saying, Debbie's going through a hard time right now. Pray for her. What is it? You just operated in a spiritual gift. Word of wisdom, word of knowledge. And then you can go to Debbie. Debbie, I was in prayer the other day. I felt like you're going through a hard time. I just want you to know I've prayed for you, and I want you to be encouraged. Now we're getting somewhere. And you know, oh, Debbie, I was caught up into the third heaven, and I feel the glorious presence of the Lord. As I was discussing with the Lord, the four horsemen of the apocalypse, he revealed unto me. That's goofy. But man, we have this treasure in earthen vessels. We have the Holy Spirit of God dwelling on the inside of us. He is the gifter of gifts. And if we'll open ourselves up to him, put away distractions for just a little bit. I want to be like that donkey and carry Jesus to our town. Let's at this point, my sermon is not going to happen. We can cut off a few minutes early today, but would you hit the keyboard for a second? And if I could ask you to do this, hopefully you've identified three people in your life by now that you're praying for. Through this 21 days. If not, now's a good time to start. But could we just take a couple moments and do something crazy and pray in church? Are you sure? Thank you for those two amens. The rest of you. Anybody need to hear this message today? Amen. Amen. Let's take a moment. Let's make an altar right there in our chair. And take a couple minutes as Andrea plays. And maybe there's three people you need to pray for right now. Maybe there's some distractions. We're not preaching legalism. Don't go throw yourself on away. Don't become Amish. Don't become Amish. That's not going to help you. But balance. And maybe while we're there in our chairs, let's pray for our nation. Let's pray for the people of our nation. Our friends, our family, our neighbors. Let's pray to have the heart of God for souls. Let's pray that we'd be that donkey. Lord God, we come as a church united today. Lord, let our hearts burn for souls. Lord, we see the soul of a nation, but let it start where we live. Let it start with our friends, our family, and our neighbors. Let it start with us. Lord, let the callousness of our heart, let it be softened. Jesus, in your word, it says that our hearts of stone would be traded for a heart of flesh. Give us a heart that feels. Give us a heart that understands the reality of hell, that understands the brokenness of those that don't know Christ, even the brokenness of those that do. Help us to put, Lord, better put our arms around those going through suffering and pain. Lord God, we ask the heart of our nation to turn back to you. Lord God, we repent on behalf of our nation. We repent. We repent. We repent for every aborted baby. We repent for our history. We repent for the times we've abused African Americans. We repent for the times we abused Native Americans. We repent, Lord God. We repent as a church for the times we've turned the gospel inward and not outward. We repent for the sins in our lives. We repent for critical spirits. We repent, Lord God. We repent. Oh God, forgive us our sins. Oh God, 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 please forgive us our sins. God, let us break. For sinners, let us break our hearts, Lord God. Let us break our hearts, oh God. Burn in us, oh God. Burn in us, oh God. Burn in us, oh God. Jesus, come into this temple and cleanse it. Come into my temple and cleanse it. Lord, overturn the things you don't want. Overturn the religion of the day. Overturn things in our life that are not giving you glory. Lord, for any of us, myself included, maybe we've had negative thoughts toward another brother or sister. Lord, help us to never, ever, ever say anything negative about anyone ever again, but to walk in love as you walked in love. And Lord, help us. Lord, even the politics of the day can be such a great distraction. There's things we hold dear as this nation, but Lord, by being distracted with politics, we can get away from the heartbeat of the gospel. Help us to hold on to your heart. Lord, I do pray that our nation for protection. Lord, at the same time, you've suffered long for our nation's rebellion and disobedience. And even in your word, you said, how long will I strive with man? Lord, we pray your will be done in this nation. Your will be done in Cloverdale, in West Central Indiana, in Putnam County, Owen County, Morgan County, Hendricks County, Clay County, Vigo County, Marion County, Lord God. Let it be done. Let your will be done. And as Christians, Jesus, as Christians, help us, Lord God, not to. Help us not to be self-righteous. Help us never to look down our nose at a sinner. Never to look down our nose at somebody we disagree with. But Lord, let our first reaction always be love and compassion and brokenness and humility. Help us get back to being the church, being Christ-like, offering the other cheek, going the second mile. Doing all we do is unto the Lord without complaint. Full of your joy, full of your peace. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, that felt good, didn't it? That felt really good. Let me say this. It's a kind of a teaser. I gotta go. I'm seeing keys. Every generation has keys. Every generation has a set of keys to it. I've begged God, I've asked God for years for the keys for these next generations. Give me the keys, God, that unlocks the heart of our country, that unlocks the heart of our generations. I stand before you today and tell you those keys are being put in our hands as a church. And I'm seeing the exact strategy I've been praying for years. It's becoming real. And the first thing is the church has to repent. The first thing is the church has to repent of church as usual. Repentance, prayer, God's presence. I had a prophecy, a word given to me by God back in 2012. I wrote it down. I just released it. I shared it with the church over the last 6 months. And everything I'm getting is lining up perfectly with that. It's not a revival of preaching. And it's not a revival of signs and wonders. This generation has seen it all, been there and done that. They're not moved by signs and wonders. This generation is so given information by Google, by Bing, by the internet search engines. Good preaching doesn't do much. But the presence of God, the presence of God, and bringing them in to that undeniable, infallible holiness of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. That's when hearts change. And when hearts change, that's when change happens. Not up here. You'll never win up here. His kingdom is spirit. And we must minister to the spirit. We've got to go now, but we needed that today. We needed that. We needed that. We needed that. Oh my. We had canceled prayer this Saturday night. It's back on. You know, if you've got Easter plans, enjoy your Easter plans, enjoy your family, bake your cake, whatever. But if you can, Saturday night at 8 o'clock, we'll be here for prayer. God bless you. We're dismissed.